Tonight, on History So It Doesn't Repeat, we discuss the concept of authority with attorney Tom Willcutts and author Larken Rose, who debate whether or not government has rights which the individual does not. Though some call it a necessary contradiction, the belief in authority has always been the most dangerous superstition. Learning's the answer. What's the question? Here's your host and navigator, Richard Grove. It's time to study history so it doesn't repeat.
Welcome back to History So It Doesn't Repeat. Tonight we have a very special topical debate between Tom Willcutts of Hartford, Connecticut. He's a local attorney, and the illustrious Larken Rose here on Skype for the first time in the studio. Welcome, Larken. Welcome, Tom. I wanted to just set the stage and say that you guys have had some friendly conversation beforehand, had a little short conversation when we did the sound check, and you guys have worked out some sort of format and link to this debate, I hear.
Yeah, I think it's going to be fairly informal, but we're going to try, I guess, limit it to an hour and a half and
keep everyone's attention. That's kind of the point,
right?
There.
And we got at least the opening sort of scripted. After that,
I think it's going to be a great conversation. I'm really excited. I'm like an audience member with a mic, so if there's something that needs to be clarified, I'm going to jump right in there and ask for a definition or clarification. Otherwise, Tom and Larken are going to act like two adults and have a logical, reasonable conversation about irrational, unreasonable things like authority and government. And we're going to see if we can flesh out the differences. They agree on some things, they disagree on other things. I don't know how it's going to turn out, but I'm excited to see what's going to happen. Who would like to go first and make their opening statement?
I could go. I think that's kind of what we ended up agreeing on.
Go right ahead.
I have the weird, strange fringe position, so I might as well go first. First of all, I'm an anarchist, in case people don't know me. The more precise term is voluntarist, which means the anarchist part just means I advocate that there be no government at all, no ruling class. Voluntarist is a little more specific. It dictates that all of human society should be voluntary interaction instead of coercion. And in their daily lives, almost everybody agrees with that. But they imagine that government has an exemption from that rule, and that when government does what would be theft but calls it taxation, that's okay, is what most people think, because they're taught to believe in government and law and authority and taught to believe that the rules are different, that you and I shouldn't attack each other, but government needs to forcibly control us and take our money and organize and plan things and make us go along with the plan. Now, I eventually got to the point where I believed that government was completely illegitimate. A lot of people I know who are anarchists got there by comparing, well, how would society be with one and how would society be without one, and which would be better? That's actually not how I gave up statism entirely. I got there by realizing that just the concept of government, just the idea itself, is inherently self-contradictory. It's provably impossible as a concept. It isn't just that when put into practice, bad things happen. For example, everybody can say, well, yeah, government can be corrupt and people can abuse power. And I got to the position I'm now at by realizing government is abuse of power no matter what it does. Government is corruption no matter what it does, as long as it's government. And so I got to the position that it isn't really even a choice. It isn't, well, do we like vanilla or do we like chocolate? Should we have a ruling class or shouldn't we? I came to the conclusion that there cannot be a legitimate ruling class, and I think I can pretty easily prove that. And one of my favorite things to do, which I think we're going to do here tonight, is using a few basic lines of questioning, take people who believe in government, whether it's whatever flavor it is, democratic, constitutional, republic, dictatorship, socialist, whatever it is, walk through a few questions that demonstrate that the belief in government is always self-contradictory, always contrary to morality and reason, whether it's giant or little or and left or right, doesn't matter. So that's my position, and
you're sticking with it.
Now we can hear what Tom does and doesn't agree with, and go from there.
So you, Larken, you mentioned this this term anarchist and voluntarist. I just wanted to fill in a little history for the audience. Anarchy was popularized by this character named William Godwin, who was married to this woman named Mary Wollstonecraft, who was a famous writer, I think, of the 1700s, whose daughter was Mary Shelley, Mary Wollstonecraft Shelley, married to Percy Bysshe Shelley, who wrote Frankenstein. So there's a long, interesting history of kind of the intellectual elite fleshing out these ideas. Then that's the predecessor to what we were born into in this generation. So Tom, do you have any response to what Larken was talking about?
Sure. I'm going to start by pointing out a couple things that I think we agree on. Larken has done a number of programs online, and he wrote a very well-known book.
We all have a copy of Larken's book.
Yeah, and so I've looked over that, and so there's a lot of the sentiment, a lot of the values I agree with, and I want to make those clear. I can't help but believe, thinking that a lot of, the anarchists you listen to, a lot of them are very much motivated by the problems with the current U.S. government. And so I'm going to flat out agree that there's a problem there, that it's dysfunctional, there are abuses. In fact, I think you can easily make a case that the abuses that exist now are greater than what the colonists faced when they decided to, we got to get away from England.
Sure, I think we can all agree on that.
Well, okay. Everyone in this room, perhaps, but
all three of us agree on that.
And I think that one of the things at play at there is this that there's kind of an illusion of self-governance under the current system, that is really this two-party system where both the two major political parties, I think, are hopelessly corrupted. It's not a choice. It's a mythology, and the mainstream media feeds it, and so it's almost like pro wrestling, where people think it's real and it's not real. Okay, so there's that. There's the value on freedom, liberty, the non-initiation of force, which Larken and other anarchists emphasize.
What about the contradictory nature of authority, which he had mentioned? Because I think, when people start from, including fallacies and unrealities in their thinking, no matter what, political parties and lobbyists and politicians are out there, you're going to have people not knowing what the truth is when presented with unrealities. They don't have a process to get to that. And that's why Larken's observing there are irrational, illogical contradictions that are being held generation after generation. And did you have a comment on the contradictory nature that he mentioned?
I do. I think we're going to have to flesh that out, because I don't think the word you're using is authority. Okay, you're not. I've listened to the anarchists and read the anarchists, and the system that would replace. In fact, you've made, I think, this point that anarchism doesn't mean you're getting rid of laws. Okay, or things we know often associate with laws, like property and contracts and things like that, right? So the answer is, you're maybe taking some of the steam out of Larken's line of questions, but you're not getting rid of authority, okay? I mean,
you're
going to be establishing a different system.
Because I just want to make sure that everyone's on the same page, especially the audience, because when I'm talking about authority, I'm speaking about the belief that there's no objective truth, that truth and truth and justice are what strong people say it is. It's kind of a utilitarian, pragmatic view where they can make up truth and say it, and because they said it, now it's the truth, instead of going from what exists and juxtaposing that to the unrealities.
Let
the guest chime in.
Can I barge in just for a second? To me, authority is not merely the ability to violently control somebody, because everybody has that to one extent or another. It's defined as the right to do it.
Right.
So the notion of authority is the guy that's allowed to boss us around and take our money. and I'll hand it back to you, but I would say not only will we do away with authority, there has never been authority. What needs to be done away with is the mythology that there can be authority.
Right,
it isn't that the current regime needs to, you know, fall into the ocean or something. It's that the belief that there can be a rightful ruling class is what's got to go.
But that's the most dangerous.
Okay, you introduce ruling class. Okay, now I'm using that definition of authority. Okay, so we're on the same definition there.
Great.
So, okay.
Do you want to address ruling class?
No.
Or how? Go ahead.
Well, I'm going to address ruling class.
Yeah, I was going to say the floor is yours. And
I'm going to get there. Okay.
The lawyer wants to lay out his case. Okay.
Let him do his opening scene. Yeah.
Okay, so I think I'd sort of finish where we agree in terms of the values. Now So now I'm going to tell you where we disagree. Okay. So, if I understand Larken's position, it's that government is necessarily evil, okay? Because it is a tool for killing, coercion, oppression, and if we eliminate government, we will thereby predominantly eliminate the main actor in creating killing, coercion, and oppression. Okay.
Close enough.
Right.
Yeah.
So.
So, Tom, you're not building a straw man. Larken agrees that that's an intellectual summary of his work.
So here's where we disagree. Government is an organizational tool that has evolved over time. All right? It is a system that a society can adopt, and it is a sort of organization, and it's a tool, and it's not unlike a gun in that sense, okay? I mean, you can look at guns and say that over the course of history, guns have predominantly had the impact of facilitating killing, coercion, and oppression, okay? But I'm pretty confident that Larken's view on guns is that guns is just a tool. It can either do good or bad depending upon who's wielding it, okay? So what I would say is that government, like a gun, is a tool, and it can be used to defend righteousness and justice or promote oppression and evil. And just like banning guns isn't going to eliminate, deciding to ban guns from, if we get together and decide to ban guns, okay, all those who agree with us, anarchists would like all their group to agree to abandon government. So if we all agree to abandon guns, if you ban guns, that just means the good people ban guns, the bad people have them. The good people ban government, then the bad people are going to have government. And, you know, because if you got rid of what you call public government, you're not going to put an end to this organizational tool. You would still have private type governments, okay? And an example of that is a corporation. A corporation is a group of people who get together, investors, and you have shareholders. They elect the board of directors, who then appoint the officers, and they have bylaws, and they it's an organizational tool that has become very powerful. All right, so you're not getting rid of that. And I've checked on the anarchists. There's pretty clear agreement that a corporation is a voluntary contractual arrangement. You're not eliminating that. Another organization that is essentially a private government is a mafia. You're not getting rid of that either, okay? So you have these organizational tools that can oppress, coerce, and kill. Now, the question is, how are you going to stand up? One of my questions to the anarchists would be, having gotten rid of the organizational tool of government, which has a history of being able to put together the power to resist these other organizational tools that can do these things, giving up that organizational tool and leaving yourself barren of that, are you going to be able to resist these other operations? I see my note here. If you don't think that corporations such as Halliburton, Blackwater,
Halliburton, Blackwater, Enron,
if you don't think they're capable of killing, coercion, and theft and oppression, I think you're being naive. And I think probably the most notable example of that is the British East India Company. That corporation was stronger than most nations. They can run armies and so forth. So all right, I think that gets a little bit of it out there.
Go ahead, Larken.
Okay, I didn't want to interrupt your opening statement. A couple quick things. Sure. Corporations only exist because of the state. Now, companies and businesses and organizations can exist, but specifically the idea of a corporation is a state-created entity that has magical special rights that just a bunch of people don't.
You're mistaken about that. But if
you had used the term, no, I'm not, you're a lawyer, you know corporations are created under law. A company.
Address it. Let him have his say, and then Tom, you can address it.
But if you had said companies instead of corporations, I would have agreed. Yeah, they can be nasty. They can be violent. They can have power. However, to me, the problem is not that, and I say this all the time. The problem does not exist in Washington, D.C., and the solution is not doing something to that thing over there. And a lot of people assume. And for some anarchists, it's actually true. A lot of people assume that anarchists want to go take the government and make it not be there. And that's not what I want. I want people to stop hallucinating that the gang of crooks in D.C. has any right to do anything. Because if you look at, you brought up the mafia. The mafia, nobody imagines they have the right to rule. And that hugely restricts the amount of violence they can do. Now, mostly the mafia makes its money off of government-created black markets, prostitution, gambling, drugs, alcohol, when that was illegal. Because you can't run a gigantic extortion racket if your victims don't believe you have the right to do it and they have guns. Now, in the case of government, the problem is not that there's this big nasty gang. It's that the vast majority of the victims of this big nasty gang imagine an obligation to obey it because they imagine it to be authority. Nobody imagines mafia to be authority. They're big, they're scary, they have the ability to hurt people, the ability to scare people and take your stuff, but nobody thinks it's righteous and legitimate. Nobody calls them government. The problem with government is it's not an organizational tool. It is by definition an entity that is imagined to have the right to do things that mortals don't have the right to do, such as steal, and they call it taxation, such as initiating violence, and they call it law enforcement, such as committing murder, and they call it national defense. The problem is not that there's this gang over there and we need to fix that. The problem is that people are imagining the gang to have the right to do things that human beings don't have the right to do, such as initiate violence. And I would use the example when people say, oh, my gosh, if there wasn't a government, some other big gang would spring up and beat us up. Imagine, put yourself in the position where, okay, you're the bad guy, and I'm going to give you about 100,000 people. Only 2,000 of them are armed. It's your job to rob 100 million people of a huge chunk of what they earn every year. You only have 2,000 armed agents and then a bunch of paper pushers. How would you rob 100 million people? There is only one way you can do it. Call yourself government and dupe your victims into imagining that them handing over their money is paying their fair share for the good of society, and call your gang the IRS. But if the victims of the IRS stopped imagining law and authority and government to be real and just recognized it as a gang of thugs, they could ignore the IRS out of business overnight. Because the victims outnumber the perpetrators a gazillion to one. It is only the belief in the legitimacy of the ruling class, the belief that we are obligated to obey it because it's authority. It has the right to rule. We have the obligation to obey. That belief is a lie, and that belief is the entire problem. And when that belief is gone, and sooner or later it will be, when that belief is gone, you don't have to do anything to government. You don't have to go abolish it. You don't have to go vote it out. You don't have to have a revolution. The people simply ignore it. And we could, because we outnumber it and we outgun it by a huge margin. But most of the victims imagine an obligation to obey the gang of crooks in D.C. When that changes, the world changes. Until then, revolutions don't do any good. You knock it over, we'll put up another one, because as long as people still believe that government can be legitimate, they'll bicker over who should sit on the throne and what kind of throne it should be, you know, parliament or a Congress or a king or whatever. But as long as they believe in authority, they will set up a new god. It will stomp on them and oppress them to varying degrees, and it'll happen over and over again. When people give up the belief that one man can ever have the right to rule another, it ends, and it ends forever.
Now, before you continue on, Tom.
Okay, sure. I was going to say how much I agree with that, but go ahead.
I think Larken's point is that people feel that they're obligated to authority, and unlike the mob, where they might just be scared into it, people are born into this illusion of government and taxation generation after generation. We didn't voluntarily subscribe to that. I didn't become part of that group and become a citizen because I made an informed decision. I did that because everyone around me was indoctrinated not to ask questions about these sort of things. So I think the asking of these questions, is it okay to not resist things that go in direct conflict with your human needs of survival? And people being obligated to obey authority, not because of any logical presentation of proof, but because they've been indoctrinated into it and said, hey, it's like death and taxes. You know, you just have to vote for these people and they will put some people in cages because laws create criminals, right? So what would be your response, and what did you think about what he had to say right there?
Well, one of the ways that bad governments stay in power is that the people accept the authority of that government. And that part I completely agree with. And in fact, the United States system has done a masterful job of creating that illusion, okay? I mean, between the education system, the propaganda, the two-party system, you know, the you know, I have described democracy as a more sophisticated and advanced form of slavery, because the slave does not rebel from himself. If you don't know you're a slave, you don't rebel. Okay, so
right. We
agree. And the view of authority that Larken is deriding, I mean, had the American colonists had that view, they would not have thrown off the British government. Okay, so that the proper thing to do is to resist the authority of an oppressive government. And I agree that I don't think you would need to do that in the United States. I don't think you would need open rebellion. You would just need to not play the game. And the game is going to significantly, they would have two choices. Either would go away, or they would have to turn to more overt oppression, which I think would be rejected by the people, as we've discussed in the past. But so we agree on that. But so then when Larken says, so then if you get rid of the bad government, it will then be replaced by another bad government, he's just begging the question at that point. Okay, that is the question. The question is, are they all automatically bad, or can you design a government that is worth having? Okay, and that's that's where we disagree.
So there's also the disagreement over terms, because once government is defined as it is, if you want to create something that's not government, that might serve a similar function but be voluntary or have other, you know, constituents of the first principles with which people in this country, you know, had founded it for a while on first principles and the Constitution and these ideas, wasn't perfect. And we can have a whole other debate about all those founding documents. But there were people under a struggle of tyranny, and they were trying to do something about it. So, Larken, how would you respond?
Well, I was just thinking maybe if Tom could give sort of a quick overview of, like, the ideal government he'd like to see, and then if I could ask a few questions about it, because I think I can quickly demonstrate that even your ideal government either isn't going to be legitimate or it isn't going to be governed.
What was the second part?
You know, I'm saying that before you even...
You'll find out what the second part is when it happens to you. When it happens to you, Willcutts, because Larken's boxing you in. So let's go with this. I'm excited now. It's on.
Yeah,
if you want to get a general description.
These Jedi mind tricks aren't going to work with these questions.
Yeah, we'll see.
Okay, so what I would say is that government designs to limit tyranny have evolved over time and have improved. Okay, so I mean, you can go back to the King of England, and
you're going
to
start with
hold on.
But you just said government. Governments, like, you know, individuals started to design some governments, but a government's not a thing that creates other things. So I just want you to be clear, you know, when you start your sentence and you're presenting that, because it's very ambiguous. And
Okay, look, here's what I'm trying to say. Okay. So you have government. Let's, you know, the King of England, that was a government, right?
Sure.
Okay, it's a monarchy. Okay. So because of the king's abuses of his power, changes in government design evolved to address those abuses of power. Okay, and an example of that is the nobles didn't like the fact that the king could just tax them whenever he felt like it. So that's one of the major things in Magna Carta. They basically said, no, king, you can't tax us. Taxing will now be done in Parliament. We will decide when there's taxes. You can ask for it. We get to decide. They didn't like the idea of a king's arbitrary justice. Okay, so they said, no. You want to say we violated a law. You want to bring a case against us. It will be tried before a jury of our peers, meaning another nobleman. Okay, and if our peers decide that your case is not valid, or if they decide your law is invalid or unjust, they can acquit, and there's no appeal from a jury acquitting. Okay, so those were two design protections, and so. Then there were some improvements in the American Constitution. So this is an evolving, to me, exercise. Now we've seen 200 years of the American experience. So do I have some design improvements over that? I absolutely do, and I can give them to you if you like. Okay.
Can I do a really quick question and interrupt you? Of these design improvements over the last 200 years, did tyranny get better or worse after the improvements?
No, I'm saying
King George compared to the United States government, which taxes more, which invades more, which does more warmongering.
Yeah. Okay. I'm sorry. What I was going to say, the 200 years, Larken, was the United States government was made a little over 200 years ago. So it's 200 and almost what?
Don't try to do math live on the show.
220, a little over 225. What I'm saying is, now that we have 225 years of the U.S. government in the books, I can improve upon that. I think your question is different. Your question is,
was that an improvement over the king?
Was the U.S. government improvement over the king? Right. Okay. So,
I mean, was the end result more tyranny or less tyranny than under King George?
King George didn't have nuclear weapons and bases around the world, did he? I mean, he did have bases there.
He also didn't have 40% taxation. He didn't have massive bureaucracies interfering in everybody's life.
You have to look at who the government is designed for, okay? When the nobles got Magna Carta, it was an improvement for the nobles, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, it's funny because in Magna Carta, it's like they have a clause for these protection of the nobles, and I think they realize, you know, this doesn't sound good. So they said, oh, and freemen have the same rights. Now, they said that, but that wasn't necessarily true, okay? Now, the short answer to your question is the American Constitution did not have the safeguards in it to prevent it from turning into the type of tyranny that they rebelled against. Okay, so to answer your question,
well, but wait, you still haven't answered the question. Was the end result of the improved system more tyranny or less tyranny?
It was tyranny. I mean, the
more or less.
You're just talking about how good they are at it. All right. I mean,
okay.
Let me put it this way. It evolved, the U.S. experiment has evolved to is equally or more effective tyranny than it replaced. I wouldn't say it's. There's two different.
There's also a neglected aspect because the first principles have been changed over time. They infected they brought in the Prussian education system to take out the self-reliance and self-esteem of individuals, which makes them much more malleable and susceptible to authority. Because if you don't know any better, and this person is coming across on the screen and they're a senator or a president or someone in a costume of any variety that's claiming that they can take your rights, you might be very encouraged by the white coat of the doctor to take the prescription and not know any better.
So to answer your question, Larken, the design features that should have been improvements in protecting the people, they failed. Okay. I mean,
and they more than failed. Well, they made things a lot worse than they were before they were even.
I don't know if that's true. I think that, you know, there's been advancement.
We have drones, man.
Well, that's an advancement in technology. So that's my point. Okay. So in other words,
advancing technology without having first principles is very dangerous.
Look, Larken, the Bill of Rights has been gutted. Okay.
I'm well.
All right. So
it's been gutted in my own house.
Okay. So the Fourth Amendment has been gutted. A number of other ones, but so there are some design flaws that where it failed. Okay, so I would improve those design flaws.
See, here's why I bring it up. There's a lot that that came up in the debates between the Federalists and the Anti-Federalists. I think the Anti-Federalists were right on almost all of it. That is worth bringing up. You know, the concepts behind the First Amendment and the Second and the Fourth and the Fifth and the Sixth and the fundamental principles they talked about, I'm all for. What I want to point out is they then tried to make a limited government. They tried to take those principles, hang on to the concept of government, and create a protector government whose only job, as the Declaration of Independence says, is to protect the rights of the individuals. And what that turned into was the biggest, most violent authoritarian machine the world has ever known. And I point that out because even though they got those principles right, I cannot think of a better example of the fact that limited government is contradictory and completely impossible than the U.S. Constitution. The most limited attempt ever to make a government has made the biggest extortion racket in the history of the world, the biggest war machine in the history of the world, the biggest, most controlling, intrusive bureaucracy in the history of the world, all based on a document that said, we're going to make this tiny little limited, just defensive government. The one thing they got wrong is government.
No.
They got so many principles right, but they left that ingredient in. They left the seed of authoritarianism in. This is what it grew into.
We can disagree on the flaws in that draft. I mean, look, the anarchists look to John Locke as their hero in natural law, homesteading. Well,
all right, so stop with your straw man there. He caught
you. Well, all right.
With somebody who
isn't all right. Well, John Locke is often identified with natural law concepts. That we're all, you know, no man has natural authority over another, that we're all equal in our rights to liberty and freedom, that our rights to property and so forth.
But you're talking about an English philosopher, and the problem is there's an unreality, there's an illusion called authority, and it starts with the fact that if you can understand the words I'm saying, that there is existence, consciousness of existence, percepts, concepts, and logic underlying all of that. And to deny any of those first principles is using a fallacy of a stolen concept.
But you're missing. Let me finish the point.
Okay, go ahead.
The point is that, you know, Locke's ideas were the ideas for replacing monarchy with government by the people.
Sure.
All right. So, in the U.S. in the U.S. Constitution was drafted within decades of his doing that, okay? It's a first draft, if you like. And the other problem is the debate and disagreement that Larken identifies in terms of the drafting of the Constitution. I think you could identify two forces there. You could identify the wealthy American class that wanted to replicate English rule in America. They just wanted to be the rulers, okay? And the people who wanted to move forward with this new idea that was used as the rallying cry to the people and continues to be the rallying cry to the people of liberty and freedom. So that was the conflict. And, you know, it's in the compromise, which is the problem, you know, how these things evolve. The compromise was this stronger central government, which the new freedom, liberty people didn't like. And in order to bring them on board, they insisted on the Bill of Rights. Okay, so that was one compromise. The other major thing at that time in terms of are we going to replicate England or are we going to be different was the monetary function of the government or how the monetary function is handled. And they did not, they just left it vague, okay? They couldn't agree, and they left it vague. And that led to the First Bank of the United States, the Second Bank of the United States, and ultimately the Federal Reserve. So, you know, the question is that I would have for you, Larken, is the government a power unto itself, or is someone running the U.S. government? I mean, there's a whole school of thought out there.
You asked the question. You got to let him answer.
Well, I was just going to say there's a whole school of thought out there of the ability of banking institutions to control a currency and then control a government. Is that happening here or no?
Yeah, I think most of what we see is totally a puppet show. Like what we see on CNN is the show put on. I mean, everything from the elections, like you were talking about before, to the House hearings on this or that other bill. It's the show they put on to make it look like that's how decisions get made.
Good. So we agree.
And that's not how any decisions get made.
So good. We agree there. So now the government is a puppet for another force. All right. So then the question becomes, if you eliminate that tool, what have you done to eliminate the force behind that's wielding the tool?
Everything.
Well, everything. We fundamentally disagree there.
Consider the Federal Reserve.
Okay.
Imagine this. There wasn't a government that people thought had the right to legislate. There wasn't a government that people thought had the right to rule. They didn't imagine it to be authority. They didn't imagine an obligation to bow to it. And along comes this big bank that says, trade with these, please. And people say, oh, that's convenient. And they trade and they say, hey, they're becoming worth less and less. I'm going back to silver. That's the end. Why couldn't they do that? Because the government that people believe in an obligation to obey said, you have to accept this. This is good for all debts, public and private. You must accept this. You can't compete. You can't make your own. And these are all things they fabricated out of thin air. They're not in the Constitution. I think we'd agree on that. But it was the violence of government saying, we're going to, in 1913, we're going to say banks are allowed to lend out money they don't have. It's legal. We have the Federal Reserve Act of 1913 that says they're allowed to do fractional banking and they're allowed to pretend they have money they don't have and they're allowed to make up money out of thin air and lend it to us at interest and do all these frauds and scams.
Who's going to stop them?
All you have to do is not use their stupid pieces of paper. Okay. But you're not allowed to not use their stupid pieces of paper because of the violence of government. Look at what just happened to Norfed, the Liberty Dollar. They're trying to put somebody in a cage for saying, let's trade with silver instead of pieces of paper. Without that violence, yeah, people can still try fraud. But when people notice the fraud, all they have to do is say, we don't want to use your fraudulent money that we just figured out. You're playing games and it's IOUs based on something that isn't even there. And we're just going to walk away. You can't just walk away when government says you're not allowed to just walk away. This is the money you have to accept. This is the money you're going to use. And we regulate the banks. We control the banks. We say who can be a bank. We monitor everybody's money under the guise of the income tax. We control the money and we control commerce and we monitor it and know all about it by way of government force. But literally, let me see if you agree with this statement. If tomorrow everybody understood the fraud that the Federal Reserve has done, and just said, let's just not trade with Federal Reserve notes anymore, and just stopped using dollars, Would that or would that not mean an immediate permanent end to the Federal Reserve and the international banking cartel?
No. Absolutely.
What would
not.
They do if nobody used their dollars? How would they get any power, any money? Nobody borrows it. Nobody trades with it.
He's saying it's the plug to their power. What happens if you pull their plug?
If everyone understood and traded with silver starting tomorrow, and nobody would accept dollars for anything, what happens to the IMF and the Federal Reserve and the international bankers and all that?
The idea that, look, we're not going to solve the problems with currency and the history of banking in this debate.
But you're noticing that there's a connection between government, and if you took away government, there would still be this power trying to have a harness over human resources. So I think we're really getting to the point where this debate's getting interesting. Now,
you'd still have people trying deception, but if they don't have government with the ability to force it on people and people feeling obligated to obey the law, fraud can only go so far. Because if people notice it, not only do they say, we're not playing your game, they also say, we're coming to get everything you have. And there won't be cops, and there won't be a military, and there won't be the giant authoritarian monster backing up the international bankers. Okay. There will be a bunch of scared crooks running for the hills.
No, that's not Larken. You haven't come up with the design of an anarchist system that would be in place for government. Am I correct about that?
You talk as a system. Anarchy is not a system. It is a lack of a ruling class.
All right. Well,
now there's ways to organize without a ruling class, but anarchy isn't a system. It's autonomy.
It's a bunch of individuals having the autonomy to make decisions for themselves.
Let's just use a simple example, Larken. All right. So let's say that you enter in a stateless society, right? You enter into a contract, so you can still do contracts, right? The anarchist voluntarist society.
You make agreement, yeah.
Okay, so let's say a lot of money's at stake. In fact, it's your accumulated life savings over four decades. Okay, but the person breaks the contract, and now you need to enforce it. How are you going to do that?
Either we aren't, or we do it with people with guns.
Okay.
The assumption, it sounds like the assumption behind the question is that government is needed to enforce things. The only thing, like the right of self-defense, which includes what you're talking about, because what you're talking about is fraud. It's theft. It's a form of theft. It's like if I go into a store and say, I'll give you $20 for that sandwich, and he hands me the sandwich and I run away and don't give him the $20, that's theft. It's the same thing as if somebody enters a contract, an agreement, and then doesn't do their side of it. They stole whatever they got from the other guy. And force is justified without special authority, without government, without legislation. Formally say, look, you did this, and society knows you did this, and we would like to give you a chance to give it back voluntarily, but there's a bunch of us that know what you did. And in fact, if you want to have your say, you can even do that. So I'm not saying you just get a club and go hit the guy over the head. There's lots of ways to make it more formal and make it more peaceful and give more opportunities to not have it turn into forcible combat. None of that requires government. Okay. The only thing that requires government is when you're pretending to have a right to do something that other people don't have the right to do. Because self-defense and getting your stuff back, whether people have the ability to do it or not on their own, they have the right to do it, which means it's perfectly legitimate and consistent to hire somebody else to protect your house, to hire somebody else to go get your car back from the guy who stole it. So none of that requires like making up rights out of thin air. None of it requires legislation. None of it requires authority. Now, a lot of people say, well, what if this bad thing happens without a stateless society? I'm not saying, and I don't know any anarchists who's saying, without a stateless, you know, without a government, nothing bad would ever happen. There's nothing in the world that can guarantee nothing bad will ever happen or bad guys won't ever get away with stuff. There is, however, one thing that will absolutely 100% guarantee that thieves and bad guys will win, and that's government. Because by its very nature, it's a beast that initiates violence. And so every government in the world has stolen in the name of taxation. whereas not every individual person has stolen. A minority of people now steal. But every single government in the history of the world commits extortion. Oh, a thing I was that I was trying to get to before that we went off track is I was hoping you would that we could start with the model of what you want government to be. You know, let's say you, lots of people who agree exactly with you, form a Congress or a Parliament or whatever organization you want it to be, and they form the exact one that you want. I was hoping you could quick, you know, give sort of an overview of what that looks like, and then let me ask a few questions about
it. Sure. I had some follow-up questions on that contrary example, but we were at this stage earlier, so we can go back to it. Because what I had said earlier was that after a couple hundred years experience with the American government design and the compromises that were made and so forth, I would have some improvements, okay? One of those improvements is there wouldn't be coercive taxation. The IRS and the income tax did not exist for over 100 years in the U.S. government, right?
Wrong.
Right?
1861 was the first federal income tax.
Okay. Yes.
Abraham Lincoln. Then it died. There was a gap, and then in 1894, the Supreme Court threw it out. It came back in 1900.
So you're saying it 90
there were 100 years without it.
Okay, so but my point is, I don't know if Ludwig von Mises was the first one who wrote that government has to have taxation and therefore has to steal, and this is absolutely a fundamental necessary feature of government. Simply not the case. I mean, first of all, you don't need coercive taxation, okay? And I wouldn't have it.
Okay.
I mean, I might charge fees or some government services, but there's a different way to fund government. There's a couple different ways to do it, but to answer your question, I wouldn't have that. So I would not have victimless crimes, okay? I would not have a standing army. I would have a militia on the Swiss system where citizens would be encouraged to have military-grade weapons and go through training and be available to defend the country, okay? So...
Sounds very anarchist so
far. Oh, no, it's... I would have a constitution that would include, something similar to the Bill of Rights. I would, in the Constitution, I would define how I would fund the government. I would also define what the government can, the services it can be involved in and what it can spend funds on.
How does it get funds?
Well,
go ahead.
Okay.
No, let's, well, let's so I, let I? Me, so the, the punishment would primarily be restitution in nature and maybe fines as well. I would not have prisons. If the criminal activity reached the point of which the person is deemed dangerous, cannot be a productive member of society, would kick them out, would exile them. That would be the ultimate punishment. Citizenship would not be required. I mean, a good government... The problem it's going to have is keeping people, keeping their numbers limited, not having to wall people in like they did in East Berlin. Okay, that's why America had such an immigration for so many years, because people competitively choosing what they saw as a superior system in terms of things like liberty and opportunity and economic opportunity. Say what you want, it was. It did have improvements.
Europe was high pressure, and they created the low pressure system in America to draw the population in.
Yeah, and we created a lot of wealth.
There would be a judiciary. Okay, the judges would not be elected like they are in some places. I have sort of details for how the court system would work. I would use the common law. I would have some.
So we can post a whole summary of this along with the video of the debate, and people, maybe it spawns a second debate or, some more feedback, because...
Right. Okay, no, that's about covered.
All right, so if that covers it, let's let Larken respond here.
A lot of what you just said were powers that it wouldn't have, all of which I agree with. Anything you want government to not do, I'm in agreement. Like, no coercive taxation, no attacking people for victimless
crimes. No monopoly on currency either, by the way. Actually, okay, I can do it real quick. Look. You asked me what the currency is. I'm sorry.
You're going to interrupt the guy who can't see you.
No, I'm sorry. I'm thinking, Larken, you're familiar with Bitcoin, right? Okay.
Yeah.
So Bitcoin is a currency that's created without taxation, right? Okay. Right. In fact, it's created by people. I don't fully understand it, but people do some tasks to create it, and they have some value, right? These tasks you perform, there's some sort of accounting or something like that.
It's not so much value. It's a computer algorithm. I don't know all the details, but I know a little bit about it. Basically, it's called bit mining. A computer sits there and thinks, and it's a way. I don't understand how it magically does that. But it's a way to very carefully limit the supply, which is crucial, while making new currency to keep up with the expanding
exactly.
Use of it.
And that
so it doesn't. It's a nothing based currency, which was my first thing to go whoa. But I think there are reasons it's actually
right.
Good
this
anyway,
is precisely
but.
What a government could do, except instead of a useless mining activity, the currency comes into existence to do the things you want the government to do. If the people want a road built, you know, the currency is created for that, just like the Bitcoin is created, and it gets paid to people. They're producing something of value, and you can control, just in the same way, you can control its levels in a sensible way so that you're not, you know, you don't got runaway inflation, so forth, and you don't have taxes. And you can, there will be some services that the government supply, like, you know, if you want to use the government court system, typically there's, I mean, they have exceptions if you're poor. I mean, but if you're not there, you know, you pay something. So that the currency would be accepted for that. But otherwise, I would not have a monopoly on currencies. You want to trade silver, you want to trade gold, you want to trade euros, anything else. So there's the currency side.
Okay. Is there anything your government... Well, like you listed a bunch of things it's not allowed to do, and I agree with everything you said it's not allowed to do. What power would it actually have? Like, would it have a monopoly on anything? Suppose you're there and you have your currency system and your court system and this, that, and the other thing, and I and a bunch of other people say, that's nice, and you know, we're not going to interfere.
Well, let me ask you a question.
But we prefer these arbiters and we prefer this currency.
Well, let me ask you.
Does it have any power to... Okay. Does that monopoly on
what
it?
Do you think the current government has monopoly on?
Everything. Whatever it wants to
well,
make up.
Well, you tell me the ones that bother you, and I'll tell you whether, you know. I mean, look, in the current, our current government.
It has monopoly on being our government right now.
Okay.
On violently extorting 100 million people? I mean, I'm sure we can agree on lots of things it shouldn't be doing. I'm asking your ideal government, what. Does it have a monopoly on anything, or can I completely ignore it? Can I use my own, you know, if I and my neighbor have a dispute and we want to go to Bob because we both trust Bob, we don't.
By the way, you can do that right now, you realize.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, I don't.
But is there anything you're going to force me to participate in or fund or go along with in your government, or can I use my own currency and my own courts
No. Okay.
And, or no courts
okay,
at all?
Okay, you, a criminal violation. You are subject to the jurisdiction of the government courts to. I mean, a crime is It really is the state's case. I mean, the victim can bring a
civil case.
Is
there a jury of your peers?
Yeah, sure.
Is nullification of an irrational law the first thing discussed among this jury?
Yeah, I have a jury in my system, which you would not, by the way, have in your stateless society. But go ahead. It's one of the major protections that you. Okay, that gets back to when
you just made that up. You can totally use juries and arbiters, and I mean the whole point of a jury trial is people want to make sure they're not punishing an innocent person. And that would still be true. I don't want to punish an innocent person. So if somebody says, hey, Bob stole my cow or my car or whatever it is, I don't want to say, let's go beat up Bob. I want to say, well, wait, I want to hear from Bob. And then I want to see proof that he did it before I say, yeah, we better do something nasty to Bob or shun him or whatever it is. People don't want to punish innocent people. So things like juries and innocent until proven guilty.
A jury
guilty.
Is a government creation, Larken.
It doesn't have
to
be.
Well, I'm not sure about that.
Well, there could be a group of people, we don't have to call them a jury, in a stateless society where everyone's participating voluntarily, and it would be a group of your peers still. We just wouldn't call it a jury because, according to Tom's legal definition, a jury is something created by a state. Is that correct?
Well, how do you get this jury to serve as a jury? Do you pay them for their time?
Well, if you don't force anybody to do anything, right. Obviously, in a stateless society. But if there's a little town and somebody's accused of doing something, I could totally see the little town saying, we got to have like a hearing and bring in the guy who said he did something and ask him, not drag him in. Ask both sides to come in and speak their piece.
The town does this.
And see, is that guy denying it and is that guy saying he did it? So that the town can hear and decide for itself what they
What's
think
a town?
Happened. I mean, that's the essence of a jury.
It's a group of people voluntarily together.
A group of people who live in a place. No, it doesn't okay. need a king to be a town. It needs to be people living in close proximity.
All right, look. I haven't heard anyone explain how a jury system would work yet, but here's what they most anarchists say about dispute resolution is that you would have an you could contract to have an arbitration system, okay? People don't contract to have jurors. It's not a jury if you do that, I don't think, actually. They're
Well, you can call it something else, but it's the same thing. It's a bunch of people who get there and want to hear the evidence and want to decide for themselves what they think actually happened before they jump on the bandwagon to say, yeah, we got to do something about this, or say, we don't think he actually
did
it.
What Larken's describing is a voluntary form of solving a problem, and jury duty is a legal obligation that they, do some sort of penalty. And so I think there is another word that maybe we're not finding that would describe the voluntary type of, adjudicating a situation.
Yeah, I'll use a different word if you know one, because, juries imply you have to show up or it'll be contempt of court and we put you in cage for not showing up. There wouldn't be that.
That's what's bad about
all right.
it. Okay, so we're just trying to get, to make sure that you and Tom are on the same page.
All right,
page.
So let's get back to, did I answer your question? Your question was the monopoly. The only monopoly I can think of, all right, is that there's only one procedure for, pursuing a criminal.
Somebody commits aggression as an actual crime. Okay, and here's my question about that. Because if I break into somebody's house or steal their car, I wouldn't, but I agree. Wait. This doesn't make sense because I have to be a schizo if I use myself as the example. If somebody else breaks into a house or steals a car, I agree that it's okay to use force against him to do something about that, to fix that, to try to get restitution or whatever. What you're saying, it sounds like, correct me if I'm wrong, there's only one group that's going to be allowed to use force against him to fix that. Is that correct?
Well, there is not only one group that can stop it,
Okay.
I mean, like the right of self-defense
Bob
exists.
Bob steals a car.
Okay, right.
Bob steals a car, he drives it, and somebody who's wandering along says, hey, I saw your car in Bob's driveway. And so a bunch of guys go over and nicely knock on the guy's door and say, we know that's Bob's car, it's missing, he didn't give anybody permission to borrow it, what's the deal? And the guy says, you say, okay, we're taking it back. Is that permissible under your system? Really?
Right.
Who would you initiate violence against for doing that? I mean, what would your system do to the people who went over and said, you have Bob's car, we're taking it back? Your government's allowed to do that, but the other guys aren't.
Well, there's the movie with Clint Eastwood, Hang 'Em High, right?
It's been a while.
Yeah, they thought they came across, Clint Eastwood is out there. He's got this cattle, and the person whose cattle it was had just been robbed and murdered, and here he was with the guy's cattle with the brand on, and they decided themselves, using your example, that he was the thief and the murderer, and they go, what more do we need? You know, we hang right. these well, people. Let's hang them. And
that's a good reason to have the principles of due process and a thing that you don't want me calling a jury. The thing that I would call a jury if you'd let me. And an investigation and presumption of innocence until, you know, you've actually proven guilt. That's a reason to be cautious and all that. I'm not against being cautious and being careful and finding out the truth and having investigators to really look into it and see, you know, because sometimes people
But Larken, your example didn't require really any of those things. Your example didn't
I know,
require
I was
due
on
process.
Purpose.
Okay.
You made up that there was some misunderstanding. That's why I said it's obviously Bob's car in the driveway. They see it. Bob didn't say anybody could take it. They go nicely knock on the guy's door. And then I asked, what is your system? Does your system allow
all right.
that?
So
you
I
know
see
what Clint Eastwood said is I have a bill. It was obviously this guy's cattle. And the guy has obviously been murdered. And Clint Eastwood said, no, I'm innocent. I got the bill of sale. And they go, no, this is obvious.
All right, we got mixed metaphors here. I understand.
I didn't ask about Clint Eastwood.
Well, right, no, right. we know. You
Larken
wouldn't.
Was talking about Bob. There's no contradictions with Bob's case. You gave this, you cited the movie Hang 'em High, where there is a contradiction. And because
okay.
they didn't have due process, they hung the wrong guy.
Okay,
right?
you're,
so we got to use the same model, right. apples and apples.
No. Look, I understand what he's. I understand.
Investigating. That wasn't the point of the question. The point of the question is, it's obvious he did it. He doesn't even deny it. He said, "Yeah, I took Bob's car." Okay, now what happens to the guys who went over and said, "Well, we're taking it
well,
back"?
Well, if the guy system. Says, "I have Bob's car," okay, is he resisting giving it back?
Well, you can do it either way.
Well.
In fact, let's do both examples. If he doesn't resist, I assume you're okay with them taking the car.
No, yeah. I mean, he's, yeah. I mean, you know, someone okay. grabs a woman's purse and is running away with it. You know, he's not gonna object. He's not gonna say no. It's. I mean, I don't know. Maybe. But would you? You know, I'd be
well,
concerned.
That's why I'm asking about the monopoly thing. Is if somebody else goes and make justice happen, is that allowable under your government? Or is your government going to forcibly stop other people from doing it? In other words, does your government claim the right to do something that other people don't have the right to do? And that's what would make it authority.
Look, you wouldn't have the right to enter someone's home to recover something, you know. Larken, it seems like your question is, due process is fine unless it's obvious, but who decides whether it's obvious? Okay, I mean,
Okay, I don't have the right to like. I think it's in your house. I'm going to barge in and take it. Okay, is there anything that the agents of your government would have the right to do that I don't have the right to do? It's just a normal person, given the exact same.
You know, one of the areas I'm not overly familiar with is citizen's arrest. I think you might, you know, there might be a reason. For having such a rule, there would be limitations. But
would your government have war machines?
But I wasn't talking about arresting people. I was talking about, self-defense and that sort of thing. What I was talking about is what you call due process, the procedure by which you decide whether or not someone actually is a criminal who denies being a criminal. That would be a state function only. There's your monopoly.
There's the monopoly. And there's where you are claiming that agents of your government have rights that human beings don't. I'm just a human being. You said, I don't have the right to do it. They do. I want to know where the hell they got it. How did human beings, me and several billion others, give to the agents of your government a right that none of us have? Because you just said, I don't have the right to do it, but your government agents do. How did they get rights that
I
don't
have?
It's
a law that we agree on in this state.
I can't agree to give somebody, like, I don't have the right to steal your stuff. I can't agree to give Richard the right to steal your stuff.
Who said anything about stealing my stuff?
I'm talking about delegating rights I don't have. If I don't have a right to, you know, whatever example you want to use, go into his house, how could I and my neighbor or 3 million of my neighbors have given such a right to an agent of your government?
Look,
that's the essence of authority, the idea that human beings can fabricate this ruling class that has rights that we don't. And what you are describing right up until then didn't sound like a ruling class. Now it totally is a ruling class because it claims the right to do things that mortals, according to you, don't have the right to do.
I think it's people outsourcing their own decision-making power and their authority to some other illusory group. That's where it becomes abused, because if I have to carry out retaliation for people aggressing against me, that's something. If I have to outsource it to my friends, that's another thing. But if I outsource it to guys in costumes, and then they go abuse people,
let me answer this question. Okay?
I just like to keep it burning.
What I have is, before someone can be deprived of life, well, they can't be deprived of life in my sense. Before they can be deprived of liberty or property, there must be due process. Okay, and that includes a jury convicting them, which is beyond the power of the government, and all these things happen. Now, the real answer to your question is that the citizens of the state agree that this will be the process.
And those are citizens voluntarily participating?
That's where the rights come from, is the agreement that you're going to do it this way. Okay, you believe in contract rights, right?
That doesn't ever happen. Yeah, you can make an agreement, but you really think 100 million people... Are you talking about a unanimous agreement?
No, a majority system? Well, look, the Constitution, I don't have any... I'm going to create a new state, okay? So how am I going to design?
The Constitution was an agreement by two dozen white landowners.
There's not one Constitution.
You know, I don't even look up
Constitution in the dictionary. It isn't the U.S. Constitution.
Might have to call somebody.
Okay, I'm referring to my Constitution, okay?
Yeah.
All right, so, look, if I'm going to create a state right now, okay, sure, I'll have every citizen, agree to the Constitution if you like. And then after that,
good luck with that.
Well,
I don't agree. I already don't.
Fine, you're not a citizen.
What happens? Do you evict me from the country?
No, not if you're no.
Okay, can I just ignore your government?
Let me ask you this: are non-citizens evicted from the United States? I mean, can a non-citizen own property in the United States?
Neither of us is condoning the U.S. empire.
Okay.
Right
no,
now.
But I'm just saying, if that is an example of bad government, and yet, you know, these things can exist there, you know.
I'm saying bad government is redundant. There isn't good
government.
Okay,
I understand.
That's
just a definition,
point,
Larken.
We finally got to the point at which we found something that your government claims the right to do and claims that I don't have the right to do it. Now, let's suppose... You know, the due process you just described, innocent until proven guilty in a trial, and you have to present evidence, and he has to have his right to say, you know, all that good stuff, which all those ways to be cautious, make sure you don't hurt an innocent person. Right. Let's say me and the people of the town do exactly the same procedure that your government would have done about this car theft or any crime. You're saying we're not allowed to, only agents of your government can, right? Even if we did exactly the same.
That's an imaginary question, Larken, I got to tell you.
Well, it's called a hypothetical
question. If you say that, you know, people in the real world, you couldn't get everyone to agree to the Constitution, you'd have a better chance of getting everyone to agree to the Constitution than what you're describing now, okay? You're describing an ad hoc group of people running a system that would protect the rights of an accused with the types of protections that we have developed over centuries. Procedure, evidence, rights to gather evidence, rights to confront your accuser, rights of avoiding self-incrimination. You know,
I know lots and lots of people who like all of those principles and don't believe in government. So I know lots of people who would exactly do that, who would make sure the guy wasn't, you didn't just presume he was guilty and punish him. He had his say, and we want actual evidence, not just an accusation. And you know, all the basic things to make sure we're not hurting an innocent person. We're not punishing an innocent person. I know a whole lot of people who don't
look.
Would
if
do
you
that.
If you want to say,
but I'm asking about the principle.
Fine, if you
are we not are is this group of people not allowed to do what the group of people over there does because they're government and they're not under your system?
When you say they're allowed to do so.
Does your government punish them if they do the same thing your government would have done?
Oh, that's a completely separate question. Okay, the question I was answering was, would people have the right to create their own judicial system and try to recreate all the protections, the procedural protections and all that, and run through all that process and do it properly and come out with a proper result? You know, first of all, it's difficult to imagine. But second of all, the question is, do they have the right to do that? And it's like, no. And there would be no real point to it anyway. I mean, if you're providing that service, okay, you know, those people who you say would be doing this. So, they're either following all the laws that exist to protect those rights. And how would they even know what those are? I mean, are they lawyers, the people who are doing this?
They don't care what the politician scribbles are. They care what the underlying principles are. They don't need to read 12 trillion law books of legalese garbage to understand. You don't just punish somebody because they're assumed, because somebody made up an accusation.
Okay, Larkin.
Like, the politician scribbles and the lawyer scribbles, they aren't the actual issue. They're
now, listen,
the things
Larkin,
that have
the,
come from
the criminal
issue.
Defendant is entitled to an attorney to represent his or her interests and the rights of the protection you would get in a court of law under procedures designed to protect their rights. So I you're saying that, well, can we recreate this ourselves? And, you know, I'm not sure I'm even imagining that. But if you want to complain that I don't give the rights to other citizens to come up with their own judicial process for protecting the criminally accused, that's fine. I'll accept that as, you know, the criticism. Now I want to ask you about your system when you're done with that.
Okay, but yeah, the entire point, and it's not a system, but the entire point is, when you have government, it always relies on the notion that there's a certain group of people that has the right to do things that other people don't have. And one example is, well, what do we do with the guy accused of stealing a car or whatever it is? And to say that this group over here, because they're agents of the government, they have the right to take him hostage and put him on trial and do this procedure. But those people over there don't have the right to do the exact same thing. And yet, the likelihood that it would be exactly identical is really low. I'm talking about the principle. Is there anything the guys called government are allowed to do that other people don't have the right to do? And the answer is either yes, in which case it's insane and immoral, or no, in which case it isn't government.
Okay.
And the reason I say it's insane and immoral is, if you actually imagine that we have given this group of people rights to do things that are bad if anybody else does them, you are fabricating an excuse for evil. Literally, by its nature, that is what government is. Whenever you say those guys have special rights and powers that normal people don't have, what you're saying is those guys are allowed to do things that are bad if I do them. In other words, government is permission to commit evil, and that is all it ever is by its very nature.
Larkin's observing.
Because if I have the right to do it, you don't need legislation, you don't need authority. The only thing you need government for is if you want to give someone permission to do something that's bad if I
understand your point. Your point is that my exclusive judicial system to protect the rights of criminally accused is this insane and immoral. I got it.
I don't think that's it.
That's exactly what he said.
What he's saying is government.
I'm saying if you say your group called government has the right to do it and other people don't have the right to do it.
Well, look, we're not talking about tax.
All right, so let me just
morality is different.
Let's just all take a step back here and just realize I can't go to my neighbors. I produce value. I can't go to my neighbors and plunder their value. I don't expect them to plunder my value. you have this thing called government that's allowed to come and tax you.
No, it's not providing a service necessarily.
I can say that
Hitler's Nazi regime is a government and did all these bad things.
Sure.
So you can't say, well, here's a government that did all these bad things, so there you go. I mean,
that wouldn't be a proof. This is a proof.
No, I heard your proof, Larken. I understand it.
The nature of government is a group that claims to have the right to do something, whether it's a little thing or everything under the sun.
I got it. Okay.
That other people can't do. It's permission to commit evil.
Now let me put this case to your anarchist state, okay? Or your volunteer state.
It's the absence of a system, really.
Okay,
it's a
bunch of people. You're a voluntarist society. How's that?
Right. Autonomy.
There's people without a ruling class.
Okay,
go ahead.
So, anyway, we have a contract that I had put forward before, and this contract puts your life savings in play, all right? Now, the person has breached the contract. Now, I hear a lot of anarchists say that, one thing without a government court system, one of the things you would do is write a arbitration clause into your contract. You think that's a reasonable approach?
Yeah, that's a good thing for lots of purposes.
Okay, so now, and another thing, you mentioned not everyone is going to be able to execute force and whatever, so you could contract for that as well. In fact, I read the description of this in a book called The Market for Liberty, and they happen to call it a private defense association, a PDA. So you're okay with that as well, right?
Yeah, if the people in it only do things that they already had the right to do, like only use force for defense.
Well,
they don't pretend to have any new magical rights that other human beings don't. It's just like the plumber knows how to do plumbing, and he gets hired. He doesn't have magical rights. But government cops pretend to have rights.
Okay.
That we don't. But private defenders wouldn't.
Okay. A private defense association. Okay. And you also said if someone that a breach of contract could be the equivalent of theft, and you can recover your property from a breach of contract, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now I'm going to give you a situation that you would find to exist in such a system, okay? You contract with a large corporation, all right? The contract is complicated and detailed, the way they often are now, okay? You're not a lawyer. They say, don't worry about that. Here's what you're going to get, and they tell you. And they tell you what the bargain is, and in the contract, and they go, and by the way, if anything happens wrong, here's an arbitration clause, and you can then... there's a way for us to force it, including it refers to the private defense association that ultimately would enforce it if necessary. Okay? Now, you didn't understand that they fooled you in that contract. You didn't understand the language, or maybe they didn't. What they claim was going to happen isn't really happening. They've really breached the contract, not you. Because they put this arbitration system in all their contracts, that arbitration system, this is a big customer of theirs. They make a lot of money of. They want to please them. Their arbitrators are therefore biased. Therefore, they're going to rule in favor of the corporation. You have lost your life savings. You didn't understand the contract, so you didn't agree to anything. What you thought you agreed to is not what the contract says, but you didn't get that. So now, you try to protect your life savings, you go to an arbitration system, they rule against you. Now the private defense association comes and takes all of your property. And that is entirely, not only is it permissible, it's predictable. It's entirely consistent with free market principles because, and you want to know why I know that, Larken? Because that's what happens right now. Okay?
I was just about to say, that's what happens right now.
Well, no, but
with a gigantic government that steals on top of that.
No.
Can I tell you a couple differences?
I can tell you a couple. I can tell you a difference, okay? That when that happened and the little people got hurt, okay? And, they went and complained to, you remember the scene in Godfather 2 where the woman comes to, who's the young godfather? It's It's the taxi guy. De Niro. Okay.
De Niro.
So she says, this bad landlord, he's raised the rent, he's kicking me out because of the dog, this little dog. And I mean, this is what would happen, okay, when large commercial companies would abuse consumers, you know, they would tell the priest and they would tell the local political guy and on and on. And they would then get together and they would pass a law to make that to ensure certain contract rights for consumers, because consumers don't have the lawyers, they don't have the sophistication, so they get protected from what they call unconscionable and one-sided contracts. So basically, as a group, as a societal group, they get together and now they have a bargaining power to put contract terms in to protect consumers that puts them on an even keel with the big corporations, which, by the way, don't go away. I mean, if you ended government tomorrow,
think that I am on the same level with the big corporations that just got billions of dollars handed to it by the parasitic government that stole it from the middle and lower classes, do you?
No, I think you would be a victim, Larken, not an oppressor. You would be an oppressor.
What am I now? What was the bailouts if it wasn't government stealing billions of dollars from normal people and giving it to the biggest corporations in the world?
Well,
and it's assumed that it's okay. No one resists because government did it.
Listen, I did an entire video on that if you want to watch it. So anyway.
Okay.
I mean, that's actually Larken.
A couple assumptions in the example. First of all, I don't know anybody who's an anarchist who says nothing bad would ever happen. People can still do fraud. People can still do violence. People can still do theft. There's no magical guarantee that justice will be served in every case in any system or a lack of system. So you can totally point to it like, what if somebody sneaks into your house at night and steals your stuff and runs away and you don't know who it was? Well, I'm poop out of luck. So one, I'm not pretending that without a state, justice always prevails. Yeehaw. Number two, that when you talk about the corporation doing these nasty things, there's, you know, I could predict what might happen. I could suggest what I think would happen. First of all, in your example, the arbitration company that did that never gets another customer and they're finished.
You're absolutely 100% wrong about that, Larken. That's not even a point of debate, okay? Those arbitrations...
Really? You think people would voluntarily go to an arbitration company if they had a choice, not a government forcing them to do it, that had been caught totally cooking the books and rigging something in favor of
oneself? I think the muddiness is you don't find that out. Like you agree to the arbitrator in the initial contract, and then later you find out that arbitrator is rotten. So you don't have that information up front when you're making that contract.
Yeah, so I would get ripped off and that arbitration company is doomed.
They are.
Because everybody else in the future would say, I'm not going to them to arbitrate.
Why?
Total crap.
Why would they not go?
Because they have a choice.
Wait a minute.
Court system, including yours, where you just said they won't have a choice. They will have to go to your government authoritarian court system, even if it's
no. Wait a minute, Larry. Let's stick to your hypothetical, okay? You, Larken Rose, got ripped off by an arbitration system, right?
Right.
Now, because you, Larken Rose, got ripped off, everyone else in the territory of the United States is not going to use that arbitration system. Tell me how that comes about. First of all,
have you ever heard of Consumer Reports? No. What do? They go out and say,
Larken,
we looked at this product. This one sucks.
First of all, how does anybody else other than you know what happened in that arbitration?
Because I say what happened.
Oh, and how do you get that out there? Do you appear on CBS?
That's why I just said Consumer Reports. They make a lot of money telling people objectively what they think of certain products. And if they get caught taking $1 from somebody pushing a product, they're finished. Because their entire job is to report to the public who's trustworthy and who's not. And you would totally have that when it comes to arbitration, even if, you know, you wouldn't even need the word of mouth thing.
Government's forced.
And you know it. As a lawyer, you know they force, and you have to be a licensed arbitration company, which means the government approves of you. And the entire court system is forced on people. If a corporation stomps on you, you take him to court. By the way, it's going to cost you this much to go to court. You're going to have to hire a lawyer and pay him $12 gajillion.
Larken, anybody can choose arbitration right now with anybody.
They can do it voluntarily and often courts.
And by the way, you don't have to be licensed to be an arbitrator. You can. I could agree that you would be my arbitrator.
Well, not privately. What? I mean, two people can say, let's have him decide this dispute.
No, no, no. Let me make this clear, Larken. The most, in terms of contract clauses, okay, let me tell you one of the most protected contract clauses that exists in the law today, and that is an agreement to arbitrate. It is, you cannot challenge that in any fashion. The courts will enforce those across the board. You can claim that it was unfair. You can claim that you didn't realize what you were agreeing
to. Okay, so that's the point right there. That you would sign a contract. Let's say we all signed a contract with Facebook on day one and it says arbitrate, blah, 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 with this company. 5 years from now, we find out that we have to arbitrate. We find out that company is rotten, and every other billion people on the planet that are up with Facebook are also signed on that to the arbitration. They signed a contract. That contract's going to be held, even though they were lied to, even though that company's corrupt. The voluntary nature of the status of the interaction is taken away in the contractual obligation, where if you find out after the fact that the arbitration company is rotten, you've already signed the contract and you're obligated to it according to what you were just describing.
I get a little excited about arbitration because I handle cases against Wall Street, and they've managed to put arbitration agreements in all their contracts. And to show how difficult that is, Senator Feingold, I think he's a Harvard Law grad and he was a U.S. Senator. He walks into a Merrill Lynch office and he actually is reading the account agreement and he sees the arbitration clause. He goes, well, I don't want to agree to this. And they say, well, you don't have any choice. He goes, what do you mean I don't have any choice? He goes, if you want to take that arbitration agreement out, you can't open an account with us. And by the way, you couldn't open an account with any other brokerage firm. Of any size and substance. So Feingold thought that wasn't a very cool thing. So he tried to pass a bill that would prevent that consumers would have the right to not be compelled.
Can they name their own arbitrator?
No, that was sort of my solution because arbitration agreements are so protected that it would be very, very difficult to, and if here a U.S. senator, he authored a bill, it got some consideration, couldn't do it, and they tried to include it in the recent Frank Dodd stuff, and they couldn't agree to it. They said, well, we'll have the SEC study it, and if they think it's a good idea.
Well, if I can just interject from my court case and my interactions with the SEC, I was under the belief that there were authorities, that they were legitimate authorities, and if you took them evidence, they would be forced to act in the public interest. And the reason that I'm sitting in my homemade studio is because that's simply not true. And once you find out you don't have these protections, it makes you start asking some questions, which is how I think we all got here.
Right. Now, when Larken talked about the bailout, okay, the banking industry is above everything, okay? It is the most protected. Wall Street is the king, okay? In the recent economic, you know, the big, huge auto corporations went into bankruptcy, not the banks. They get the money, even though they caused the whole thing, okay? And the reason they did is because and congressmen stood up and said this on the floors, they could go back there and say, if you don't do this the right way, we can freeze the entire system. We can, you know...
So they've got power, that authority.
Well, Kissinger said, if you control food, you can control people. You control oil, you can control nations, you control money, you control everything. Rothschild is...
And Steve Biko said...
Most potent weapon in the hand of the oppressor is the mind of the oppressed.
There you go.
Sure, look, we're not disagreeing on that.
And I brought that up, Larken, because last time Tom was here, he was here with Chengi Aragavan, who was a mentor to Steve Biko. And so I just wanted to bring that full circle, that the mind of the oppressed is the most potent weapon that they have. And back to, you know, Larken and this most dangerous superstition, this fallacy of the belief that there's an authority beyond logic and reason in existence Do you want to comment on that, Larken?
Yeah. See, we got into this particular example of arbitration in courts and disputes and things like that. But the whole, like, what everybody wants government to be is a big thing that's more powerful than anybody else that'll make sure the good guys win. I mean, that's, and people will disagree with who the good guys are, but that's what everybody wants. And that's what everybody says we need government for. They say, well, bad people would do bad things to you if we didn't have a government to stop that. And they always talk as if government, for some reason, even though it's just made of people, even though we're giving it permission to forcibly control us, it will be on the right side. It will protect us. And then it turns around, stomps on us and robs us and oppresses us way more than the private crooks did. And then it stomps on us on behalf of the private crooks, like the bailout and the Federal Reserve. But the problem, you know, it starts with a good intention. I want the biggest guy on the block to be a good guy. And I want him to be so big and strong, nobody can beat him. So you get this big, huge, strong guy, and then you find out he's not a good guy because we just told him he's allowed to control us and take our money. And that's what government always turns into. Now, on occasion, it will protect some people against other aggressors. You know, sometimes a cop will stop that bad guy from attacking that innocent person. Great. That doesn't require government. The right of self-defense is perfectly legitimate. You can organize that voluntarily. You can fund it voluntarily. That act doesn't require government. The one that does require government is when the cop says, by the way, you didn't pay your taxes. We're kicking you out of your house. An act of aggression. So all of that, however intricate or simple or basic and whatever the specific issue, arbitration or a guy stealing a car, whatever it is, I'm all for organization and cooperation and formal procedure to make sure you get it right, to make sure you know the facts, a thorough investigation, an unbiased person making the decision so we're clear on what actually happened and what we're going to do about it. None of that requires government. The only thing that requires government is saying that guy is the final decider. That group has rights to do things we don't. It's up to them, because then what happens is we imagine them to be gods. We imagine them to have rights to do things we don't have the right to do. And even the Constitution did that. It was supposed to be limited, but Congress shall have the power to lay and collect taxes. Wow, I don't have the power to lay and collect taxes. Who the heck gave it to them? Larken,
even if, you know, set aside my experience where, you know, major corporations are able to, I mean, they're the ones that we all know, they're the ones that write the contracts. So, and if they put the same arbitration company in hundreds of thousands of contracts, that's where that arbitration company is getting their profits from, okay? But let's set that aside. Let's say that you and I, as ordinary citizens, enter into a honest contract and we write in an honest arbiter to resolve a dispute to our contract. When you do that, you are signing over to that arbitrator authority over you to make a decision that is going to affect your property, okay?
Except it isn't the same, because it's a voluntary agreement. It's like if I say, I'll sell you my car for however many dollars.
But see, Larken, my concept of a well-designed government is that it would be voluntary. Okay.
Then it isn't government.
Well, you can say that, but I mean, you know.
Well, see, this is why I asked before. I was trying to get to, like, well, can I just ignore it? Like, does it have a monopoly, or is it just, if it's people voluntarily offering a service, fine.
No, look.
If I can take it or leave it, I don't care. But that's not government. Everybody can ignore it. Nothing
but
happens.
But Larken, in your book, okay, you deal with this concept. It's called the social contract theory of government. The idea that the citizens agree to be members of a government. And you say, no, that doesn't work.
Complete bunk. It's not that it doesn't work. It's an utter lie. It never happens.
Well,
we're told you consent to being ruled by falling out of your mother onto this piece of dirt.
But it's not a logical impossibility. Okay, it's the same consent that you give when you enter into a contract to let an arbitrator decide your welfare, your future, your property.
Except that, no, the equivalent would be somebody saying, I want to make a deal with you, and by the way, I get to take your house if anything goes wrong. And by the way, you don't have a choice. You're going to agree to this because your other choice is get out of your house and leave the country.
No, look, okay.
Like, you can make voluntary agreements with, and you know, one person, a huge company, whatever it is, but government isn't that. Like, the government of a territorial jurisdiction, whether it's a country or a state or a local thing, says, we make up the rules. And if your house, your home that you bought or you built is on inside this imaginary line that we said is our jurisdiction, we can change the rules all we want. And if you don't obey, we take your house or we put you in a cage. That's not an agreement. If my choices are which master is going to rule me, I didn't consent to any of it.
First of all, look, I agree with you. The United States doesn't fit the social contract ideal. Okay. But there may be other governments, you know, I don't know all these.
Well, you're both talking about things that don't exist yet. And the reason they don't exist yet is because there's plunder versus production, because there's people believing things that are not true. And then they, you know, get together and you have groupthink. There's a whole bunch of dynamics. It's really interesting, but you know, let me just break the tension here for a second. What's the difference between the mafia and government? The mafia doesn't have a 15,000-hour indoctrination system to convince you it's not the mafia. Now, I heard that from Brett Vanon. He'd probably credit Stefan, and Stefan would probably credit Larken. But the idea is that there's a whole indoctrination system set up to make us think that this is all normal and that authority is just there as natural as trees. And authority is something created in the minds of men. It's not part of nature. It's part of an unreality. And part of that unreality that I see driving, you know, the ability for people to be productive is not because of these people who plunder, but rather the people who are plundering are made, you know, wealthy by all these hard working people who take in this idea of authority without resistance at all.
Yeah, I didn't get past your mafia thing, but anyway. No, I mean, because, you know, mafia has a bad, I mean.
I'm not saying anything bad about the mafia at all.
Well, look, I mean, you know, you had these immigrants coming in. They didn't speak the language, okay? They were shut out. They're basically shut out of the political system.
They're entrepreneurs, in my opinion.
Well, they were really, if the government wasn't working for these immigrant peoples that came in, they sort of set up their own government,
right?
Okay? I mean, when you see Don Corleone and Godfather 1,
people
are coming to him for justice.
And other people needed protection, right?
No, I mean, so it was sort of a government within a government.
It was filling in the gaps where government wasn't covering everybody.
It wasn't automatic.
It was also a lot. It was also a lot more honest than government. Because
gangsters. We use this term government as though, again, you know, if you want to take an example of a bad government, it's just like I'm sure there are a lot of bad mafia gangs, but that doesn't mean they were all bad. Okay, all the time.
Bad is a subjective term.
All right, and the same with government. Okay, we can't, you know.
But it isn't the same, because government, by its nature, is a group of people imagined to have rights that other people don't have. Imagined to have the right to do things that other people don't have. By its very nature, what the term means is a group that has the right to do things that are evil if I do.
Larken, we're back to your signing a contract and giving a group of people that power over you. And now, so the real difference is, you say that's okay. So the real difference is it possible for citizens to get together and form an organization that basically accomplishes the same thing? You say, well, it's never happened. Fine. You know, I'm not sure that's true, first of all, okay? You could find a small town that there's that island in the English Channel, the Guernsey or whatever. I don't know if they do it there. Or, you know, Liechtenstein.
Not saying that never happened. I'm saying it either is voluntary or it's government. It's either moral or it's government. It can't be both. There are plenty of organizations, whether it's three people or 1,000, that say, let's all agree to do things this way. And they do, and it's voluntary, and they do it that
now,
way.
Now, what you're, Larken, you're saying that the social contract theory of government, according to you, can't be a government. Because if it were a government, it would be a good thing. And since you're defining government as a bad thing, by definition, it couldn't be government because it's a good thing.
No, the social contract excuse that's used for government.
Well, I'm not favoring being used as an excuse. Okay. I mean, if it's a lie and a deception, you know, it's like a contract that's...
Well, that's the only context I've ever heard social contract used is, well, by living on this piece of dirt, you agree to do whatever the masters say and pay tribute to
them. No, you're assuming taxes. Okay, so if you have property, let's say, again, in my state, okay, it has geographical boundaries. You own property. You don't want to be a citizen. You're fully entitled not to be a citizen. You won't have any duties of citizenship. There's a couple of rights that you probably would be missing.
Can I own property and not pay taxes to a school that I feel is corrupt? I don't pay taxes to a government that wages war.
In my nation, there are no coercive taxes.
But again, that's a hypothetical. Why hasn't your nation taken place yet?
Why hasn't anarchy taken place?
I could answer.
Or go ahead, Larken. Larken's the guest. Society, you know.
Because people hallucinate the thing called authority. Like, as long as they imagine there is such a thing, they're going to keep fabricating one.
There's another possibility there, Larken. Okay, which is that a societal setup or organization that can't efficiently compete with others is just not going to survive. It's going to, you know, it's. I mean, you know, whatever the take the Marxist ideal. I mean, even if their society, you know, even if their organization weren't corruptible the way it was and became oppressed, you know, they had a good plan and idea. They wanted to get rid of certain oppression. And even if they had succeeded in getting rid of that oppression without replacing it with a new oppression, they were going to be, by competition, they were going to go out of existence, okay? So that's another problem you have with your society. Your society, if you had a state, if you had a geographical area,
When a lawyer says, trust me, I just had this whole idea in my head.
You have, you know, so many square miles in a block to the east, and I have the same to the west. You have your voluntary society, I have society I would design. People would leave yours and come to mine, okay? So
I can't wait to visit both.
We would be all for it. But see, you're missing the fundamental thing. You're talking as if these are two ways to organize, like we're having two football teams. One's going to have a captain who decides the plays, and the other is going to democratically choose which plays to do. You're talking as if there are two ways to organize humanity. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about people today hallucinate the possibility that one human being can acquire the right to rule another. When they understand that that is not possible, not just that it's destructive and can be abused and, you know, has murdered several hundred million human beings, but that the idea itself is insane.
Hey, by the way,
once they understand that, there won't be, like, yeah, there can still be crooks, there can still be bullies, but nobody will imagine them to have the right to do that, which means society as a whole will naturally try to resist it and fight against it.
You don't have the organizational power to do that.
You don't need that. See, that's a perfect example. You don't need organizational power to not believe in Santa Claus. You don't need a giant movement to not believe in Santa Claus. You don't need, we got to get together and really form a, there isn't a Santa Claus organization. When people give up the belief in government and recognize it as being just as insane, only way more destructive, as the belief in Santa Claus, you don't have to like do something to make society. Then you have free human beings, and free human beings decide what to do. All the belief in authority is this mutant mental psychosis that is viciously twisting humanity and causing mass extortion and constant warmongering and violence, because people imagine that political processes can make evil into good. When they stop believing that, then people will be free to arrange in ways that are actually sane and moral. As long as they believe in government, they're going to keep organizing in ways that are inherently destructive and insane.
As long as people keep believing in Santa Claus, they're going to continue celebrating Christmas and waiting for the reindeer. Santa is an unreality. One of the problems I noticed is that people believe things that aren't true. This idea of authority, whatever you call it, is irrational. I'm not talking about experts. I'm not talking about going to someone who knows the craft or trade right. better than you. I'm talking about someone who claims that they can tax you, they can rule you, they can tell you where you can't move, what lines you can't cross. And
go ahead. And Rich, when you sign a contract, you give people
that. I signed
no
contract.
When you sign a contract, you give people that authority.
Sure.
But you don't.
But when I go to a different town.
You don't say, I hereby agree that you get to run my life. You agree to, I will do this if you do that. If you sign a contract that says you're allowed to rule me and tell me what to do and take as much money as I want, you're an
idiot. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about what Stefan Kinsella, a legal scholar on anarchy, what Rothbard, what Hoppe, these guys say that in their stateless society, you sign a contract. The contract includes a dispute resolution. You are giving to that dispute resolution company authority.
I have no argument over that. My argument is I was born into this country. I was subject to all sorts of laws, taxes, all these sort of things. Everyone around me was. And so it took many years to even discover that that system existed because it's like air. It's like fish in water. You don't know. The fish wouldn't know about water until you took it out of the water. Right. So you don't understand that taxes are a form of human resource harness. Just like anything else that we've been talking about through this discussion. So I just want to bring it toward, tying up all these loose ends. Larken, your video is the tiny dot and If I Were King. The only things that I recall thinking, critically beyond agreeing with most of what you said was the reason that all those dots have not, the reason that hasn't happened yet, that the desirable end result where people realize that they don't need authority is because that there's a lack of connectivity and media and communication of a cogent, rational variety among those tiny dots. And that's what you're saying. There's too many of those tiny dots that haven't got the message of a dangerous superstition and just adopting anything without thinking about it. Holding a belief is like stopping at a rest stop and not the destination. You should be continuing to gather evidence, to observe, to define, and that's how you arrive at knowledge and make informed decisions. So I would think that a lot of those things weren't done before any of us signed up to Selective Service or Social Security or, any of these other things that we all kind of have to participate in. And it's the thousand strings that tie Gulliver down, if I might use a metaphor.
Yeah, and in the tiny dot, I intentionally don't explain it and I don't resolve it. I just leave it, like here's this huge throng obeying this little
dot. Well, I think that's what we're doing now.
To see how many people can try to explain it.
I liked the tiny dot video. I thought that was
good. It was awesome.
And the things we agree on, another thing we agree on, Larken, is I agree that you have no compulsion to follow a law that you find morally repugnant, okay? I got to tell you, this goes at a young age. I would guess I was a less deferential authority than probably you are, and I've always been that way. Okay, to me, that's just not part of my constitution. But what I would say is that people and lands and cultures who have been dominated by the West, right? Okay. I would suggest that the reason the West has been able to do what it's done is mainly due to organizational advantages. I mean, the Islamic countries, the Far East countries, they're doing well in science and technology, a lot of things compared to the West. When the West developed the corporate organizational structure and certain features of their governmental structures, that's when they flew by, okay? You can't turn back the clock on human evolution when it comes to advancements in organization. All you can do is try to use those organizational tools
to do it wisely,
in a good way.
You have to ask the question, what does this new technology give and what does it take away? And is what it's taking away part of our core values, our needs to survive? And I think a lot of those decisions have been made over the decades in the past century that people didn't ask those questions. They just assumed that if Eisenhower was telling them to do it and he's on TV, that that's a good thing to do. And I like Ike, right?
So one thing I would object to is this notion that, I mean, government organization was evolving, you know, and it went from predominantly monarchies to this representative notion, all right? It's relatively new, all right, in the whole scheme of things. The American Constitution, you know, they didn't know what was going to happen. There was competing forces. They fought. They compromised. Now we have the experience. I think you have a roadmap to where you can learn from that and try to fix it. So, and I understand we disagree about that, Larken, and that's, I think, why we had
this
debate.
Well, I think some of the disagreement's inherent in the Constitution because there's some first principles that were assumed, and then you have the Bill of Rights. And instead of reasoning from that which exists, which everyone has to experience, and that's why we have needs to survive, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, they made some assumptions, and now people can say, the starting point isn't existence, it's not that which exists, it could be authority. It could be, you know, a religious authority, yeah. Political authority. Go ahead, Larken.
The problem is that most of us haven't learned the one thing to learn. I mean, if the Constitution should have taught us anything by taking the most limited government in the history of the world and building the most powerful authoritarian empire in history, it's the one ingredient that you have to leave out of it is authority and government. The idea that we need forcible organization. Government is not an organizational tool. It is a violent domination tool.
I understand that.
We need a servant tool, not a domination tool.
Listen, I understand that theory, but you need to understand that there are substantial...
Well, it's not a theory. It's the nature of the thing.
Well, there's substantial scholarship out there to the effect that by not providing for control of the currency, that you basically open the door to turn the government into a puppet tool, okay? And so if that's...
You can't have a government being a puppet tool if there isn't a government.
Well, okay, and you can't kill someone with a gun without a gun.
Yeah.
Okay, so, all right, so...
You can use a gun purely defensively. You cannot use a government purely defensively, or it isn't government.
Yeah,
if it doesn't claim to have rights that I don't have, it isn't authority.
Right. Let me ask a question.
Guys.
Since what we have are a bunch of people who don't act as the servant of the people, you have a government that's made up of individuals who are abusing that power. If we didn't have payment to those people, if they were on a voluntary basis voted, held to certain strict adherence to logic and reason and non-aggression, which is it's a derivative proof of that which exists, and it's not doing anything involuntary, you might not want to call it the government, but you could still have people at the service of everyone else to get these same things done and not have what comes with it, this authority. No, they're not an authority. They're a servant of the people. And if governments were created to serve and protect these rights, I certainly, you know, there's a little bit of a circular reasoning there, because if you could protect your own rights, you wouldn't need this other group of people to fight the king, right?
That's
the only ingredient that needs to be removed, authority. You can have an organization, you can have defense, you can have – and a lot of what you're describing, I'm all for it. It's when you finally got to the point of saying it's allowed to do this and you're not, that it remained government and remained destructive.
You guys are really close. You're really close. There's a little bit of difference there.
Well, except that one, that one step is really dang
important. Is it meaningful, Larken?
Because the choice is either I own myself – or somebody else is my master.
Now, what if you...
And there isn't an in-between.
If you don't own yourself, and you don't own the means of your production, and you know, you're on welfare of the state, and you're taken care of, I mean, what does that mean to you?
I'm not even a person anymore.
Right.
So, you know, Larken, in my nation, you can opt out of being a citizen. No one's going to require you to be a citizen.
Okay, but you still think it has rights to do certain things, not very many things.
Well, the same, but there are no rights that you don't recognize anyway. You recognize, I haven't heard an anarchist yet who does not I mean, the anarchists, I mean, they say we're not a pacifist idealism. What we are is, you know, so we believe in, they, you know, they believe in criminal punishment. Okay. I mean, what was it? So when I hear these PDAs describe private defense associations, not only can they, you know, wield weapons and use deadly force, they can operate, the idea is they will operate prisons too. Okay. So you're going to have privately run prison systems.
So says you.
No. That's like,
first of all, don't make me try to defend what somebody else.
Well, you were always making me defend bad government. So why shouldn't I make you defend?
But you're defending the concept of authority. You're making up what other people say they would do in the absence of the state.
But it's the same authority. It's the same authority that you grant when you enter into a contract.
But that's voluntary.
Voluntary.
Okay. If I agree with some arrangement and sign an arbitration clause, I'm saying in that little context, like if I'm hiring you to do a service and if something goes wrong, we'll go to this. I'm not saying I agree that you are my rightful lord and master. I will do anything you say.
I'm not agreeing.
There's a pretty big fundamental difference.
My government doesn't have that.
Okay, so the chasm, the difference is you're talking about your specific, your own unique brand.
I think
you
just said it was a little bit
pregnant. I know, but you're talking about your unique brand of government that you've thought up, and we're talking about that which exists kind of now. And I just wanted to make sure that you understand that there was a little gap there, because when I made this comment to you, you're like, well, I'm talking about my form of government. I only heard a couple of those steps, and I wanted to make sure, because I'm actually dealing with reality and not the hypotheticals. I'm trying to bridge the gap to figure out what could be created to resolve these problems, as opposed to, you know, sending another 10 generations through this country who don't have a clue about self-reliance or that which exists. And, you know, my cup is a cup, and I can't make this into gold because of the law of existence.
Right. Like,
that's cause and effect.
So, right. Rich, like, one of the biggest objections to anarchists is they don't live in the real world.
An elitist, Godwin, made up anarchy, I'm not part of that group.
Walter Block is a professor anarchist. Okay. And so he made this self, I was listening to him give a talk, he made this self-effacing joke. He goes, you know, so you got a physicist, a chemist, and an economist, since they think the free market's going to solve everything.
Sure.
And
I could throw in a quantum physicist like Galambos from Princeton and his...
So anyway, the problem they have to solve is to open a can of stew, because they're like shipwrecked and it's food. And the chemist, you know, the physicist wants to drop it from a certain height. The chemist wants to apply heat to it, whatever.
Sure.
And the economist says, let's imagine a can opener. Okay.
This is sort of the math opened it for them while they were all doing that. So let's get back to the issue at hand, the unreality. Go ahead, Larken.
Talking about living in the real world, sure. Can I take you through three really quick, really simple, really basic lines of questioning to prove that authority does not and cannot exist?
I couldn't believe you didn't do that in the first five
minutes.
Please
do.
I was waiting for this.
Yeah, I've been wanting to do it the whole time, and our conversation flies in lots of interesting directions. Can you delegate to another human being a right you don't have?
No.
Can two people delegate a right to another human being that neither of them have?
No.
Can a billion people delegate to another person a right that none of those billion people have?
No.
Can anybody in government ever have any right that I don't have?
By agreement, yeah.
Whose agreement?
Who agreed to give them a right that none of us had to begin
with? Again, the social contract theory of government.
When I got here, there were nuclear weapons. I didn't agree to that. I have no say.
Right. If you want to talk about a bad government, I can tell you some problems with...
it's not about a bad government. It's about people cannot give to somebody else rights they don't have, which means people in Congress do not and cannot, in this Congress, in your Congress, in any government...
On the planet.
Literally can't have a right that I don't have.
Right. I mean, that's why, that's why we're talking about this and I built a studio, because there's no country on the planet that I could really move to and get this good type of government, because all these different places seem to be run by a gangster cult already. So it's just, you know, I'm trying to work it forward.
Wait,
go ahead.
But let's quick do the other two. I think you actually already did one. Can you ever be obligated to do what you think is wrong? If an authority tells you do this and you think it's bad, can you have a moral obligation?
Well,
you might do it out of self-preservation.
It's a question of degree, Lark. I mean, like, you know, you mentioned the football team, okay? So let's think, I'm a player, and I think, you know, the rule that you can't one of your teammates can't push the ball carrier over the goal line is a dumb rule, okay? And it's stupid, and I argue against it or whatever. But it's a rule that, you know, if you're playing the game, you got to play by a set of rules. So that's true of a lot of laws. Now, but
you agree that you got to play by, you know, you think the right thing to do. You think the rule is dumb, but you think the right thing to do is play by the rule because the game doesn't work.
There are certain things that you need a set of, that it's valuable to have a set of rules. That in certain activities, without a set of rules, you're not going to be able to do well. Now, to answer your question, if you have a fundamentally immoral law, okay, I mean, where you're talking about doing something, you know, that violates fundamental rights or something on that order, then no, you absolutely don't.
Okay, good. And yeah, you basically said that before. Yeah. The reason that makes the concept of authority explode is what it boils down to is you, Mr. Government, have the right to rule me in certain ways unless I decide that you don't. And that makes the notion of a rightful ruler just go poof. And the thing is, everybody believes that. Everybody, I can find an example where they say, well, in that case, you should break the law. Well, what you're saying is this human being should obey the authority until I decide I shouldn't. Well, that means you're above it. It's not your master anymore. Just stay above it. Don't jump down below it and pretend you have an obligation to obey. Do what you think is right instead of what the master's telling you.
Well, Larken,
Milgram experiment.
No. So here, here's the example, okay? Again, you enter your contract. You agree to a dispute resolution. You are, and this actually happens, okay? In this dispute resolution, you are right, the other person's wrong. He lies, and the person believes them. And therefore, you, by your contract, have the decision to wrongfully give up your property or not. Okay? And,
But there's no, you know, whatever I decide, I may think, well, it's not worth fighting because they're going to win anyway. Or I may think, no, I'm going to resist. I decide...
You agreed to be bound by something that is unjust, okay?
Yeah, but I'm saying whichever direction I go in, I can never think, you know what I should do? I should do what I shouldn't do. And that's what the belief in authority requires. It requires believing I should do what he says I should do, even when I think I should.
Let me tell you something, okay? So the other person on the other side of the contract lied, but he won because the arbitrator believed him. It's an unjust result. You now have the decision. You could decide, depending on the circumstances and the gravitas, you could decide, I'm going to resist this. Okay? And you, there's a moral argument that you would be right. Okay? So that's a choice that you make. When a government becomes... You know, this is what the colonists did, and this is what the Declaration of Independence says. It says if a government reaches
abusive,
you can reject it. So that notion of rejection,
can we still reject it in this country? Because I think they take you off to a prison.
I think Jefferson would say you could. They were prepared to take the colonists. We're going to swing together or swing separately or whatever. Yeah. We're going to hang together. Okay.
The thing is, that clause was a giant contradiction. That was the good part where they said, "Hey, if it becomes
Let me tell you, you're not going to be able. What you want to do. And I majored in, I have a degree in philosophy. I went through the logic courses. I read your stuff. I heard you. You want to construct a logical proof, okay? You can't do it. I mean, John Locke was not, you know, he didn't like miss some fundamental mistake.
Oh yeah, he's got a lot of dogma.
Absolutely.
There's a lot of dogma. I agree with him.
He missed the biggest mistake in the history of mankind.
All right, well listen, you can have that opinion, but I can tell
you that's the next debate.
You
is about Locke.
If you tried to construct a logical proof Too bad. I'm imagining he's looking at me, you know.
I just did too. If people can't delegate rights they don't have, people in government can't have rights I don't have, which means they're not authority. The end.
Okay.
His terms are clear. His premises are true, and therefore his argument seems to be valid. What do you find a fallacy in it?
Because it's the same as his contract. He's giving authority to an arbitration system. Okay.
No, I'm not.
When you sign a contract, I didn't.
You made up that example of if that happened, that never happened.
Right, but
I didn't agree to have anybody rule me at all ever. Who else in the world, if everyone else in the world wanted to give to Congress the right to steal my money, could they do it when none of those people have the right?
People could come together and agree to be taxed. I didn't.
That's not what I asked.
That's fine. Right. That's fine.
7 billion people, do they have the right to agree to take my money when I didn't agree?
I would say, here's what I think, okay?
That's a one-word answer, yes or no.
I think no person should be compelled to be a member of any government, okay?
So, why don't you answer the question? It's not a complicated question. You can elaborate afterwards all you want. Can 7 billion people give the right to steal my stuff to another human being?
Don't yes appeal to no laughter.
I think I already answered that question before.
Is it yes or no?
It's only yes or no. Saying yes or no is shorter than saying, I think I already answered that before. So can we have a yes or no? Can 7 billion people give somebody the right to rob me?
No.
And that's what a constitutional republic was supposed to be, that 99% couldn't take away the rights of the one person here out of the 100, right?
Except Congress shall have
power. Oh, sure, of course, yeah.
Taxes. Whoops.
Yeah, it's word magic. I mean, the Constitution and Declaration are definitely spelling. It's the uses of linguistic architecture to frame out a constitution, if you will, a body that can be occupied. But, you know, that's another future debate. So I think we've had a really good exchange of initial ideas, and we found more than we agree, more that we agree on than we disagree on thus far. Tom, would you want to make, I'll give you guys like each 5 minutes to make a closing statement, and then I would move to have a future conversation where after we've mulled over what's been said and what's left on the table, that we can pick up some of the unanswered questions and move the ball forward. Does that sound amicable?
Sounds fun.
Okay, sure. You want me to go first?
Yeah, I can you know,
yeah, no,
I can cut
okay
to you looking smart or something.
Yeah, so again, man is by his very nature a social creature, okay? And as a consequence, social organizations have evolved. And the ones that were effective, lasted. The ones that were not, you know, went by the wayside. And so it's evolved to the point where, I guess one of the main points I would make is that a lot of the protections that government could provide, like the protections that the nobles got in the Magna Carta, and that the wealthy American aristocrats and nobles, if you want, got in the Constitution and so forth, these protections can be effective if they're both designed, if they're designed to protect a certain class of people, all right? You know, the jury system is one of the few systems that actually works for the little guy. All right, I mean, it absolutely. I have direct experience with this. I have gone up against the largest corporations in the world. Okay, and if I can get in front of honest jurors, you know, their power, you know, in that case, you know, they can lose because, you know, it's not a elected body. It's not a big arbitration system that caters to corporate interests, large corporate interests, and makes that's where they make their money. It is, you know, it is a functioning protection by the people for the people. Okay, so I will concede that a lot of these, I mean, the you look at Magna Carta, I mean, Larken and, you know, and a lot of the anarchist commentators, I mean, their major focus is a government taxes, that's theft. Okay? So the nobles felt that way when it came to the king. And they stood up and they said, no, you can't do this. Now that, unlike the jury protection that they also got, that then passed on to the people, that one didn't, because the nobles became, the king went away and they became the government. So they didn't mind taxing because they're the one doing the taxing.
The document was an end result to memorialize the fact that the barons formed a gang, an effective gang, and didn't they kidnap the king? And
well, the barons the barons were able to design a protection within government to protect themselves from plunder by taxes. So it's and they designed a protection to protect themselves against arbitrary justice. Now, they try to say that this, that these protections flow to the people. The jury system did. The protection against taxation didn't, okay? And one of the things that, that people, I don't think, recognize about what happened in colonial America when they revolted is that one of the things the history books don't write up is that they were, there wasn't a lot of gold and silver. I mean, the only gold and silver was stolen from the Spanish ships and brought over, you know, or you know, it was traded for goods in Cuba or something like that, okay? And it would make its way to the colonies. It would soon go back to England because they got all, you know. So they came up with their own currencies. And
like nails were embargoed by the empire, and, it, you know, people would sit by the fire and make their own nails. So that's a good example.
And by going with their own currency, they actually created prosperity. And the British government, and the that's when the Bank of England was like asserting its power, and that was privately held. Okay, and so that's one of the background reasons. And unfortunately, that's one of the things with they rebelled against, but they didn't then create the same protection themselves. So in any case, you can design the protections. And unfortunately, they're too often designed for the elite, all right? But that's not to say that you can't design it for the people. And the problem is, if you don't give the people that organizational ability to resist organizational power, whether it's, you know, the East India Company or Halliburton or, you know, the major defense contractors, these aren't going away if you eliminate the state. In my experience, representing the little guy against corporate interests, they're not, I don't know what chance they have, okay? So it's proven to work when it's designed to work for a class of people. We just have to design it to work for the right
class. We just have to be that class of people for whom it works?
That's right.
All right, great. Okay, Larken, go ahead and close it out, and if you don't mind plugging your website or your books at the end, that'd be great.
Yeah, well, I almost had to bite my tongue off.
I know. I saw you, dude. I was like, here's a guy who's seen a jury.
As a great protection. 12 complete imbeciles stuck me in a cage for a year for not sending a piece of paper to the federal extortion racket. And the only reason they did it is because they believed in authority. Because an authority figure said, I didn't do what I was supposed to. They didn't say I had hurt anybody. They didn't say I had threatened anybody. They didn't say I had harmed anybody anywhere ever, because I hadn't. They said he didn't do what the masters told him, and they said guilty. Juries are no protection against anything if they believe in authority.
But Mark, you had the passion you have if that didn't happen, though.
Of course you
did. Yeah, because I already did. Okay. I probably wouldn't be quite as annoyed, maybe. Might not be quite as rude, but I was already an anarchist before any of that happened. Okay, so just as an aside, no faith in juries as long as they believe in authority. Now, as for protection and organization and, you know, yeah, we're a social creature. I'm not saying everybody run for the hills, every man for himself. Organization doesn't require special authority, doesn't require a ruling class. Defense doesn't require special authority. Nothing inherently moral requires legislation to make it moral. I mean, that's sort of a truism. defending yourself against fraud and attackers and all the nasty things that can be done, all the forms that fraud and force and violence and aggression can take, defending yourself in an organized way, cooperating, it can be formal, it can have all these procedures, all of that's good, all of it is inherently moral, and so it doesn't require authority. The only thing that authority adds to the mix is the idea that there are some people with certain exemptions from morality. That's all government is the group imagined to have certain exemptions from the rules that apply to everybody else. But as long as you keep that element of there's going to be an authority that has certain powers that normal people don't, you're keeping an element of there are going to be certain people that are allowed to do evil stuff, stuff that's bad if I do it, stuff that's bad if you do it. That is the belief that has to go. We can have cooperation, we can have society, we can have defense, we can have justice, we can have all these formal procedures, but until the lie called authority is gone, there will always be violent aggression, and not just because there are nasty people, but because there are billions of people that hallucinate legitimacy to evil when it's committed in the name of authority. When the people stop imagining that law can make evil into good, then we can start being human beings.
Well, I think what he's really saying is that when you have this belief in something that doesn't exist, this irrational belief of authority that someone can do something that you can't, and it's all good because they have a costume on, that's really pointing toward a trend that has brought us through thousands of years of history and has not yet been effectively resolved. And the hypotheses that I've heard weighed in tonight from each of you are substantial. They're relevant. I don't know that either one is, fit for reality. They might be a little too utopic in some area, but I haven't found those areas yet with what Larken's saying, because there is a logical proof that, existence exists. You have certain inherent rights, and the derivative of that is non-aggression. So giving other people rights that you don't have to tax people, to plunder their production, it seems something that exists because people continue to believe things that aren't true. And what he's saying is the resistance in people's minds are turned off when they think authority is okay and that it's logical and reasonable, and that if only people had a common point of existence and reference where they could say cause and effect exists and everything else that follows, then they would say, well, it's logical to resist someone who's trying to have authority or dominance over you in such a way that you don't agree to it.
Because that's exactly what the American Revolution was.
Right, exactly.
And see, some of it.
Some of it.
And see, but that's the problem. If evil were only committed by genuinely evil people, we'd be in a lot better shape. But today, literally almost everybody I know advocates that I be forcibly robbed, because they imagine that when such robbery is called taxation and done by authority, it's legitimate. Right now, you literally have almost everybody on the planet, except anarchists and voluntarists, advocating the initiation of violence against their fellow man because they imagine that government and law makes that into a good thing. In other words, the good people condone evil because they don't recognize it as evil because they believe the lie of authority. When they recognize it as evil, then they'll try to stop it. Instead of voting for it demanding Congress give them free stuff.
I got to tell you, the same problem exists in corporations, okay? You'll find, you could be neighbors with someone who seems like a completely nice and whatever, and they could belong to a corporation where it's just expected, or the culture, or, the authority of their employers that they do things that they would never do on their own. So that's the problem. You can create these organizations which are capable of doing these things. And we know, and then the question becomes, when you have these types of organizations that do this, how can the average person resist them? And
it comes back to individual self-defense.
I understand. Basically, the anarchist in a nutshell thinks the free market can do this. Okay.
Why doesn't the free market exist now?
I think the free market is what there is. Government is a lie.
Larken, look, those are definitional. That's not an empirical claim. That's a definitional claim. Okay, you're defining something.
It's easy to prove. It's hard to accept it when you've been indoctrinated into it.
Tom and Larken, I wanted to thank you guys for participating in the inaugural venture of our debate format. You guys were both very polite. I'm proud of your performance. Larken, you did an outstanding job presenting to an empty screen because he doesn't have video to see the studio right now. So when you're watching
I'm here yelling at a history icon.
Well, he said how much practice he's had doing that. So
and so, Larken, when you're watching this at home finally, you know, welcome to the studio.
Then I can see what you look like and stuff.
You're courageous for participating at this early stage. I appreciate your patience as we went through some technical difficulties before we got started. Tom, as always, I want to thank you for suffering the hot lights of the studio and for humoring everyone at home who doesn't understand some of these hypothetical things, because I think through questioning between you and Larken, agreement on some things is needed for it to be constructive, but disagreement on some of these major points that, I mean, need to be fleshed out in the minds of everyone are there as good food for thought, and I want to thank you for participating once again. And you've been watching History So It Doesn't Repeat. This was the testing of the new debate format, and I'm sure it'll be back, maybe a little bit improved next time. And in the meanwhile, thank you for tuning in and not dropping out.